563 and item 14, SB 642. We will proceed to our first item on today's agenda. Our first author who is present is Mr. Simidian. Mr. Simidian is here on item number 11, SB 558. Mr. Simidian, good morning.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman and members.
I should note at the outset that we're convening as a subcommittee until we establish a quorum. Mr. Simidian, please proceed.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members. This is Senate Bill 558, co-sponsored by the California Advocates for Nursing Home Reform, the Congress of California Seniors, the California Alliance for Retired Americans, and the Consumer Attorneys of California. What does the bill do? It does one thing, quite simple. It reduces the burden of proof in an elder abuse case from clear and convincing to preponderance of evidence. That's what the bill does. It says that if you walk into a courtroom and prove that there has been a case of elder abuse or neglect by a preponderance of evidence, that you will have met the standard required by the bill. Why is that the appropriate standard? Mr. Chairman, that's the standard used in most civil cases. If you had a case for medical malpractice or if you had a wrongful death suit, the burden of proof would be preponderance of evidence. The irony here is that what we're trying to do is something we've already done, a piece of legislation I authored several years ago, which is to reduce the burden of proof to preponderance of evidence for physical abuse, as we already have done for financial abuse. Some years ago, I authored legislation that put the burden of proof at preponderance for financial abuse. It's worked well in the intervening years. Now we're trying to do the same thing for physical abuse. What makes this particularly appropriate in this case is that these are the kinds of cases where there are often not witnesses. As you can imagine, if someone is frail and elderly, unable to take care of themselves, if there is a case of abuse or neglect, the abuse or neglect is often not something that the person who's been abused is themselves capable of reporting or defending themselves on, making the case. Oftentimes, there are not witnesses who are present. If there are witnesses who are present in an institutional setting, they may be the employees of, and that is to say, drawing a paycheck from the company that would be disinclined to have them testify or participate. So we're simply trying to make the burden of proof in these cases consistent with what it is for financial abuse and consistent with what it is in a host of other cases. The one other point I want to make is there is already an extraordinary burden of proof in these cases because not only do you have to prove that there was abuse or neglect, but you have to prove that the defendant was guilty of recklessness, oppression, fraud, or malice in the commission of the abuse. So there's already a double burden in connection with these kinds of cases. The point here, Mr. Chairman and members, is we have an Elder Abuse Act on the books for two reasons. The first is to serve as a deterrent so that we won't see this kind of behavior. The second is to make sure that there is some measure of justice for folks who have been damaged as a result of these kinds of abuses. If we don't have the ability to meaningfully pursue because the burden of proof is set too high, then we can't be surprised that the deterrent doesn't work and these behaviors aren't deterred, and we can't be surprised that when there is an abuse, that no measure of justice is available. I would respectfully ask for an aye vote, and I do have witnesses.
Very good. Mr. Simidian, before we proceed to your witnesses, we have a quorum. Let's establish it, please.
Fuhr.
Here.
Wagner.
Here.
Atkins.
Here.
Dickinson.
Here.
Gaines.
Here.
Huber.
Here.
Huffman. Jones.
Here.
Monning. Wachowski.
Here. A quorum having been established, can we have a motion on the consent calendar, please?
I'll move the consent calendar.
Is there a second?
Second.
Call the roll, please.
Fuhr.
Aye.
Fuhr, aye. Wagner.
Aye.
Wagner, aye. Atkins.
Aye.
Atkins, aye. Dickinson.
Aye.
Dickinson, aye. Gaines. Gaines, aye. Huber.
Aye.
Huber, aye. Huffman. Jones.
Aye.
Jones, aye. Monning. Wachowski.
Aye.
Consent calendar is approved. Mr. Smitty, your first witness, please.
Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Catherine Stebner. I am a practicing attorney in California. I brought my first elder abuse case in 1987. I am on the board of Consumer Attorneys of California. I co-authored two chapters in the continuing education of the bar books on both financial elder abuse and physical elder abuse. I'm here to talk about sort of from the trenches as someone who's been in this area. My entire practice is elder abuse now for many years. And there's a problem, and the problem is the purpose of the statute is not being met in the state of California. And I just want to give just a very recent example that's happening to me right now. I could give dozens, but my time is short. I have a case currently where a elderly woman came into a nursing, was in a nursing home, came to a hospital with severely infected bed sores, had to have an amputation. Her hematocrit and hemoglobin were so low that the emergency room doctor said that it was worse than someone who she'd seen come in with a gunshot. The facility's response was that she was anxious for 2 days. The emergency room doctor and the head nurse both reported this as elder abuse. I use this as an example because there's a summary judgment has been filed in this case, as well as almost all my other cases, saying that it has to be clear and convincing evidence, factual evidence, that this woman was not recklessly abused. The problem is that she's dead. And the problem is in 90% of my cases, the my clients are the family members, really not the elders, usually the daughters. And they come to me, and there is no one to rebut the witnesses from the facility to say I was abused or neglected. And in summary judgments, this is a major problem, and that is one of the reasons this is not working in the state. This is not medical malpractice. There's two Supreme Court cases that says that. Basically, this is not professional negligence. This is not a failure to treat or to diagnose. This is systemic. This is recklessness. This is a nursing home who knows that people are in danger, and they do it anyway. One of the things of someone in my place, I consider myself someone like a private attorney general. With the budget cutbacks, unfortunately, it's very, very difficult for the state of California to go and look over these nursing homes. And so you need to basically arm us to go out and patrol the nursing homes and make sure they're not abusing elders. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. Next witness in support, please.
Thank you. I'm Prescott Cole. I'm senior staff attorney with CANNR, California Advocates for Nursing Home Reform. I've been there 16 years, and part of my duties there are to talk to people who call in. These are family members or sometimes the residents themselves that have issues with abuse or neglect in nursing homes. The heart of this bill, of course, is damages, and it's the damages for abuse and neglect. The attorney has to prove that there was abuse and neglect, and the attorney has to prove the conduct of the caregiver was either reckless or there was intentional conduct on the part of the caregiver. So ADACPA really offers one thing that you can't find anywhere else for the dependent adult or the elder, and that is pain and suffering. Pain and suffering will survive the death of the elder or the dependent adult only under ADACPA, and then only if the attorney can show that there was abuse and neglect, and if only if the attorney can show that the conduct of the caregiver was egregious. And egregious is the term that the California Supreme Court used in Delaney v. Baker. It's not about, as they said, garden variety negligence. This is neglect. Now, the major difference, and we know that the opponents are bringing up MICRA, and they're saying that this is an assault, a backdoor on MICRA. But MICRA does not give pain and death damages after the victim is dead. And as Catherine Stebner just said, 90% of what she hears is where the elder or dependent adult has died. And unfortunately, in our system, the only thing, the only damage that somebody who's 95 years of age, who suffered a stage 4 decubitus ulcer, is going to be the pain and suffering. That's not available anywhere else. And what we are doing with this bill is not changing what the attorney has to show. We're only changing the burden of proof from clear and convincing down to preponderance. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. Next witness in support, please.
Good morning, Mr. Chair and members. I'm Gary Passmore with the Congress of California Seniors. We are very proud to co-sponsor this legislation and urge your aye vote to protect frail elders and dependent adults.
Thank you. Others in support?
Henny Kelly, Oh, thank you very much. Henny Kelly, I represent 900,000 members of the California Alliance for Retired Americans. I'm also here representing my mother, my mother-in-law, my father, and my father-in-law, who all were in nursing homes. Our members depend on good care. We need this law changing this abuse to preponderance of evidence to give them protection. We urge an aye vote.
Thank you. Others in support?
Thank you, Mr. Chair and members. Kathy Sunderling with the County Welfare Directors Association on behalf of the County Adult Protective Services Programs in support.
Mr. Chair, members, Deanna Firma on behalf of the California Nurses Association, also in strong support.
Thank you. Others in support?
Yes, Mr. Chair and members, Ignacio Hernandez on behalf of the Consumer Federation of California in support of the bill.
Thank you.
Alex Graves of the Alzheimer's Association, also in support.
Wait, with whom, excuse me? What is your affiliation, please?
Alzheimer's Association.
Others in support, please.
Michael Radigan on behalf of the Board of Supervisors, Santa Clara County, in support.
Thank you. Are there any other witnesses here in support of Mr. Simidian's measure? Are the witnesses here in opposition to the bill? Good morning. Please begin.
Good morning, Mr. Chair, members. Dave Helmsen on behalf of the California Association of Health Facilities. I'd like to acknowledge that this is an important issue and is one that deserves the attention that Mr. Simidian regularly focuses on it. I'd also like to assure the committee that there's no one in this system that does more to deter, detect, train, report, eradicate elder abuse than the clients that I serve. They have programs in place specifically for that purpose, and I think do a very good job of that. Not that we're perfect, and I'm not here to defend any poor performance in the system.
Mr. Elton, hold on 1 second.
Sure.
It's hard for the witness to concentrate with people in the audience speaking. Mr. Helmsen, please continue.
Thank you. I would like to dispel some of the material I've seen on this, though, that I think really does mispaint the character of this issue. We see references to GAO reports that are 10 years old that say that states aren't doing enough in this area. Just for clarification, looked at 3 states, not California, specified in the report you shouldn't generalize these results to any other state. And in fact, California had virtually every recommendation they made already in place prior to their report. I also hear the number thrown around that 91% of these facilities have problems related to patient care. That is a number that is derived from the deficiencies found in a system that employs over 1,000 people in California. Their job is to go find deficiencies. They range from insignificant to serious. The problem with stating the way that the proponents of this bill have is the fundamental problem we have, is they want to pull everything that goes on, every unsatisfactory outcome in a nursing home is elder abuse. I'm not making that up. Virtually every claim that's filed on a nursing home problem includes a claim under elder abuse. So people are clearly not discerning the difference at some point in this process. We oppose lowering the standard. We understand the rationale, but we do oppose it. We don't believe that lowering the standard in any way removes a major obstacle to regress in the courts for folks that are seeking that. California leads the nation, and I'm speaking from a nursing home only perspective, although the bill is a little broader, but I'm familiar with nursing homes. We lead the nation in cases in litigation. Our awards have tripled since the implementation of ADACPA, which, by the way, we were part of the agreement to implement ADACPA in the early 90s. Virtually, as I said, every case includes a claim under ADACPA now. And their attorneys are more than willing to make, as we've heard, a career out of these cases. So there's no shortage of access. What this does do and why we oppose it is it lowers a standard that was specifically included in the original agreement. And I realize we revisit agreements here from time to time. But the architects of ADACPA felt that it was important to make sure that only the egregious cases got to the level of elder abuse or neglect. There is a blurred line around neglect and negligence, and people are making a living off of that blurred line. And you'll hear either side tell you one thing or another about it. But at the end of the day, this burden was put there to help the courts discern that difference. From lowering the standard, we can only draw, there's only several valid conclusions to be drawn, or we wouldn't be here talking about this. This is designed to, in fact, have more cases qualify for the enhanced remedies that don't exist anywhere else in the legal system. Okay, as that happens, fewer cases are pursued as negligence. Fewer cases receive micro-limits. The costs of settlements, the pressure on settlements goes up. The costs of providing or of meeting the litigation demands in the facility go up, and that does move money from care to litigation. We don't think that's a good idea. Also point out that studies have shown it doesn't contribute to quality. There's no rhyme or reason to how facilities get sued based on their, quote, performance. It's more based on their resources. So we'd urge a no vote and believe that while this is a genuine issue deserving of attention, this is not a solution that makes sense to us. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. Others in opposition?
James Gary. I'm an attorney with Hanson Bridget. I've spent over 30 years of my legal career representing health care providers with a subspecialty in nursing homes. I have represented numerous health care providers in these negligence and ADAPA cases. First of all, let me make it very clear. Every single case filed against the nursing home for any claim of negligence has an ADAPA claim in it. So the attempt by counsel to say to you that all they do is file in the most egregious cases and the cases that qualify under ADAPA is absurd. That's it. Every single case. What is the practical impact of that? The enhanced remedies. It's not the pain and suffering, as portrayed to you a little while earlier. It's the attorney's fees. When you go into a settlement conference, every settlement judge says to you, you are going to have attorney's fees awarded against you if you lose, and you're going to get attorney's fees awarded for every single hour that plaintiff's counsel can portray to the judge they used in this case, regardless if it had anything to do with the ADAPA. The flip side of that is the defense cannot claim attorney's fees. That's the enhanced remedies we're talking about here. In any other case in the state of California that I'm aware of where there's a negligence claim, you do not get attorney's fees. You get pain and suffering and you get damages. In these cases, and the reason we have the enhanced standard of proof is you get attorney's fees, and the attorney's fees drives the litigation. And so, as counsel mentioned, summary judgment motions are filed typically by defense counsel. They have a judge review the facts, and if the judge is not convinced that it qualifies under ADAPA, that cause of action is thrown out, the attorney loses attorney's fees, and then the case is settled for what is a appropriate dollar amount. There's another issue that I've seen raised from time to time in regards to this bill, and that is, why not have the same level of proof of financial abuse as we have for the physical abuse? There's one simple reason. They're two entirely different torts. In the financial abuse, typically what you're talking about is a family or friend stealing money from the elderly person. It is extremely rare for a financial abuse case to be filed against a healthcare provider. I can think of two cases in my entire life, and one of them dealt with about a $1,000 claim. So when the standard was lowered in that case, the reason you didn't see a great outcry and increase in cases against healthcare providers is because it never existed. Now, in the tort of physical abuse, which is the type of case filed in nursing home or any other healthcare providers, the essential claim is you neglected the patient, therefore we get the enhanced remedies. A case where a resident sits on the bathroom tub or sits on the toilet and falls over, hits their head, even with two caregivers in the room are trying to assist the person, you will still have an ADAPA claim filed. And so what it really comes down to is the enhanced remedies we're talking about. As long as you're going to give enhanced remedies of attorney's fees for a simple negligence case, which is what's being asked for today, you're going to drive up the settlement tenfold. And rather than simply getting compensatory damages and pain and suffering damages, you're going to roll into this equation $300,000, $400,000, $500,000 of attorney's fees in every single one of these settlements.
Thank you. Do you have any additional points you wish to make?
that was it.
Thank you. Thank you. Others in opposition?
Peter Kellison on behalf of Aging Services of California, which represents continuing care retirement communities and the nursing homes therein, California Association of Health Services at Home, which represents private home care, home health, and hospice care. And let's be perfectly clear that this issue has been largely quantified as a nursing home issue, when in fact, the issue is really about a grievance between a plaintiff's attorney and a provider. That under the case of home care and care for the terminally ill, hospice, the lowering of the changing of the standard to in the case of neglect provides substantial opportunity for increased litigation for, against these providers, especially in the case of hospice, where the cost of the liability insurance that they will have to bear that will be increased will also have to be paid, have increased costs to the Medi-Cal program, which is responsible for 75% of the liability insurance borne by providers. So they are in opposition to this legislation also.
Thank you. Others in opposition?
Mr. Chair, members, Tim Shannon representing the California Association of Professional Liability Insurers. These are physician-owned medical malpractice carriers. Just to echo the remarks that have been made before, we are seeing increased lawsuits against physicians that routinely, when it involves a dependent adult or a senior, has one of these in the plaintiff's cause of action. I have the benefit or burden of having been around when the original law was enacted in 1991. I was working for CMA. It was a trade-off. Because of the enhanced remedies that were put into the law, the burden was higher. And the author stated what this bill is very simply. It is simple. It just changes the rules. It's one team coming in and saying, we want to lower the basket from 10 feet to 8 feet. Make it that much easier to make their case. Thank you.
Thank you. Others in opposition?
Mr. Chair, members, Dean Grafila with the California Medical Association, who have a position of oppose on SB 558. Before I briefly state the reasons for our position, let me bring clarity to an issue that had come up in some of my visits. Some of you may have been informed that SB 558 would not apply to physicians, rather that this bill is specific to a healthcare facility. That is not the case. SB 558 would apply to physicians because in a 2000 California appellate court case, Mack v. Song, the court ruled that the patient was under the physician's care and custody, and that even as an individual, he was subject to the Elder and Dependent Adult Abuse Act. Now, for many of the reasons previously mentioned, we oppose SB 558. Without question, those that endanger the safety and care of the elder and the dependent adults should be prosecuted to the fullest extent of the law. However, we do not agree with changing the way plaintiff attorneys can receive enhanced remedies under the Act. By lowering the legal threshold, there will be an inevitable increase of lawsuits filed under this Act, as mentioned in the analysis. This is a particular concern in part because in 2003, the California Court of Appeal confirmed that the Elder and Dependent Adult Abuse Act does apply to hospitalized patients under the age of 65. In this case, the court did not discuss the legislative intent of the act or the consequences of allowing every hospitalized patient to bring a suit under the Elder and Dependent Adult Abuse Act. Make no mistake, the upward trend in the cases filed under this act will only continue if SB 558 prevails. Increased litigation does nothing to improve patient care, as noted in a March 2011 New England Journal of Medicine. For the physician community, an increased exposure to lawsuits will deter medical residents from choosing geriatrics as his or her specialty and expedite current geriatricians to leave this specialty. With the graying of California's population and incoming influx of insured patients with federal health care reform, California's physician shortage crisis would be exacerbated for this population under SB 558. Rather than discourage geriatrics as a specialty, as does this bill, we should advance policies that increase access to care for this vulnerable population. I respectfully ask that you vote no on SB 558.
Thank you. Others in opposition?
Chairman and members, Barbara Glazer on behalf of the California Hospital Association and on behalf of our 120 hospitals that operate skilled nursing facilities, we too are opposed to SB 558 for the reasons stated.
Thank you.
Craig Brown for the Cooperative of American Physicians. We represent about 11,000 doctors in a self-insured environment, and we're opposed to this measure for the reasons stated.
Jack Christie for Aging Services of California. We represent not-for-profit providers of affordable housing, assisted living, and skilled nursing care. We oppose this bill.
Catherine Pettibone with the Civil Justice Association of California. For the reasons stated, we're also in opposition.
Sherry McHugh, representing Californians Allied for Patient Protection. We, too, are opposed to the bill. Thank you.
Mayor Gerton, on behalf of the California Chamber of Commerce, also opposed. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Members of the committee, questions or comments for Mr. Simidian? Mr. Wykowski.
There's some questions been raised about what is a dependent or what would trigger a person becoming a dependent under this act.
The act doesn't change those existing rules, sir.
So, assuming this legislation, so that whoever would be deemed a dependent under the existing law from 1991 would be a dependent. There's
That's
no
correct.
Extension.
That's correct. If you, through the chair, if you look at the bill language itself, you'll see that the bill is actually very brief. And actually, the vast majority of what you see in the bill language is existing law. The only amendment to existing law is to change the burden of proof.
There's been testimony by the hospice community against this act. And I'm wondering, normally my understanding is that somebody goes into hospice because this is the end of life. I'm not seeing a cause of action for recklessness in the final stages of somebody's life that would bring them under a cause of action for this. Do you have any idea the basis of that opposition?
Well, I can't. It's not really my place to speak for the basis of the opposition.
Mr. Wykowski, do you have a question for the opposition or a question for the author of the bill?
Sure, I'll ask the opposition.
On behalf.
I'm wondering, my experience with hospice care is that this is the last week or 2 weeks of someone's life. I'm looking at the burden of proof of there has to be oppression, fraud, and malice. I'm wondering how somebody would bring a cause of action if they're not in the hospital care, but just through going into the hospice care.
Absolutely. On behalf of California Association for Health Services at Home, hospice care is eligible for the last year of an individual's life who's terminally ill. They've given up on curative care. They're not necessarily in the last week or 2 weeks of life, although that is where the majority of hospice patients receive their care. The concern that the providers have is the potential for neglect and the vagary of neglect in terms of what sort of care is or is not provided. How is that defined? It opens, especially in the case of the family members of a terminally ill individual, in particular after they have passed away, that there is substantial grief, there is substantial, all the different feelings that go along with the passing of somebody that is loved or a family member. The concern that they have specifically, aside from that aspect, is the vagary of neglect and or neglect and negligence. That is where their issue is in terms of the concerns that this would increase potential litigation against hospice providers, which many of whom, if not the majority, are not-for-profit providers, although many are for-profit. That's their issue. Pardon me.
Thank you, Mr. Wykowski. Mr. Wagner. And then Ms. Atkins.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm not sure I have very many questions. I think I've got a couple of comments and really want to explain my trouble with this bill, and maybe you can resolve those. It is true we have this Elder Abuse Act on the books. We've had it for about 20 years. It's my understanding that when drafted, these provisions, including the attorney's fees, were subject to some negotiations and a trade-off, and attorney's fees comes with the heightened standard. And now it seems like we're undoing this deal that got done 20 years ago. I'm not sure I have seen a case, certainly not made here, but even in my own practice, that there is a problem that needs to be remedied. In fact, one of the witnesses suggested to me exactly why I think we don't want to go where we're going with this bill. You told us a story about an unfortunate woman who's passed away, so she's not there to testify. Well, in criminal cases, victims are often not there to testify. Those are murder cases usually, and we have an even higher standard. So there's not something automatic about the incapacity of the victim or the unavailability of the victim saying, well, that's a reason to step down. That's especially true if what I think is going on here is in fact what's going on here, that these attorneys are acting as private attorneys general, Well, the Attorney General has a higher standard, especially when prosecuting criminal cases, than even the clear and convincing standard here. And, you know, these private attorney generals, these attorneys are patrolling, I think was the witness's word, the nursing homes. Well, we haven't deputized you to do that, but if you're going to do it and you're going to get your attorney's fees for it, I think it's fair, because nobody has shown me the statute hasn't worked, that we at least ask for a somewhat higher standard than mere preponderance, a mere 51% of the evidence, especially when there isn't a victim there to say, here's what really happened. Whether the victim is dead or the victim is otherwise incapacitated or cannot testify on his or her behalf because the victim is confused. In opposition, I thought we got, you know, a very cogent explanation of these problems from Mr. Helms, and with respect to the difference between the financial and the neglect and why there would be a different burden, it's clear that in the financial abuses, you've got money, receipts, bank records, a whole string of documents to make a case. You don't have that here. And so it's fair to ask for the heightened standard of proof, isn't it? Just like we do in criminal cases. And we aren't even going as high as we do in criminal cases. So with all that said, I think the change takes us in the wrong direction. And I guess you can address it now or in your close. But I really think we're going the wrong way for the reasons that were explained.
Through the chair, if I may. And I'll circle back to Assemblymember Wachowski's question earlier. We're having the wrong conversation, Mr. Chairman. I've listened to people on both sides of the table today argue the interests of institutions, professionals, attorneys, fees, legal standards. There's been precious little conversation about the people we're trying to protect. A year ago this week, my 88-year-old father passed away. He had 24-hour care in the final months of his life. He had marvelous help from a hospice, by the way, who do God's work on this planet, in my view. The conversation shouldn't be about these competing interest groups. I understand that this is the Capitol building. I understand this is the Judiciary Committee. The conversation ought to be about what does it take to protect people at this most extraordinarily vulnerable time of their lives. I don't know each of your stories, members, but here's what I do know. Every one of you had a mother and a father. And looking at the age of the members, if you're lucky enough to still have your parents with you, I'm guessing that they're at a time in their lives when they're particularly vulnerable. So the question here is about what will work to protect those people. You haven't heard me say an unkind word about nursing homes, and you won't get me to. You haven't heard me say an unkind word about legal practitioners who look out for people who are particularly vulnerable, and you won't get me to. What you've heard me say is that if these folks are particularly vulnerable, yes, they do need folks who have the tool of state law to serve as a deterrent. And if the law doesn't work, then there is no deterrence. And if there is no deterrence, we can't be surprised that there's going to be bad behavior, whether it is an individual caregiver or an institutional caregiver. So the argument I'm making is that we need a standard that makes the deterrent real, and that if the deterrent hasn't worked, we need a standard that provides some measure of justice after the fact. Now, on the issue of attorney's fees specifically, I think many of you know the attorney's fees in these cases are not mandatory. They're discretionary with the court. The law says that they may be awarded. And the court exercises its judgment about whether or not the fees should or should not be awarded. Moreover, the reason the statute provides for attorney's fees is not because of the burden of proof level, but the reason the statute provides for attorney's fees is because the statute recognizes that absent the willingness of private practitioners to step up and handle these cases, There's no one there to help. There's no one there to hold the system accountable. We're not changing that in the law. We're simply saying that if you prove the case, and the suggestion is that there ought to be a higher standard. As I referenced in my opening remarks, there is a higher standard. The higher standard is that you not only have to prove neglect or abuse, you have to prove that the person who is charged was guilty of recklessness, oppression, fraud, or malice. A much higher standard, a second set of proofs that have to be made in order to make a case. So the question here, with all due respect to witnesses on both sides, if we can put aside the lawyers, the docs, the institutions, the interest groups, and ask ourselves, what is it that it's going to take to protect people at this time in their lives? The answer is a statute that works both as a deterrent and to provide some measure of justice after the fact. The MICRA argument that was raised is wholly specious, with all due respect. MICRA, as members will know and as your staff will point out to you, is contained in Civil Code sections 3333.1 and 3333.2, with some references over in the B&P Code and the Code of Civil Procedure. If you look at this two-page bill, you'll notice that the only thing it amends is the Welfare and Institutions Code. It doesn't touch MICRA. The only thing it amends is the Welfare and Institutions Code. And your staff did a very nice job on page 7 of the analysis of pointing out that the court in Covenant Care versus Superior Court made clear that the MICRA limitations on actions for damages arising out of professional negligence were not meant to burden those who pursue the cause of abused elderly persons under the Elder Abuse Act. Two separate different conversations. The bill doesn't speak to MICRA in any way, shape, or form. I hope that's responsive to questions we got from both sides.
We have, Mr. Wagner wants to return. I have others. Ms. Wagner, is a quick and direct response, because I want to return to Ms. Atkins, followed by Ms. Huber and Mr. Dickinson.
I will be brief. I think we are focusing on the right thing, and the right thing is how do we protect these vulnerable people, which is why in my comment I said I'm not sure I see the case that we need to change the standard, because as it is working currently, or as it is currently framed, it is not working. And that's the case that has not been made here, but that is the focus that ought be of this committee and this legislature on protecting those vulnerable people. Show us how they aren't currently protected in light of the objections made by the community that is in fact responsible for caring for these folks, that if you change this standard, the nursing homes are going to have greater burdens, greater costs. Some of them are going to go out of business. Quality of care ultimately may end up declining. Why make this change to protect those people when in fact it could have unintended consequences and is not shown yet to be necessary, because it is not the same thing as financial abuse?
What I'd like to do, if I could, Mr. Simidian, is allow, you'll have an opportunity to respond to that point again. I know you've dealt with it already some extent in this hearing. I'd like to hear from our colleagues and return to that question, among others. Ms. Atkins.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate the discussion. It's been helpful. I spent a lot of time yesterday on this one bill.
Thank you, ma'am.
Trying to understand. Can I have both the opposition and you, Senator, speak a little bit more to the issue of enhanced remedies? Because, you know, we had a bill was pointed out to me here not that long ago that talked to trying to rectify some of these issues related to accountability, in my non-legal opinion. So can I ask Mr. Helmsman and maybe you, Senator, to respond to that both, if that's okay with the chair?
I just, Ms. Atkins, ask you to refine your question a little bit. What precisely are you asking of both sides here regarding enhanced remedies?
Well, it seems to me that what we're trying to do is to enforce protection related to elder abuse in a way that changes behavior. And it seems to me it changes behavior, and of course the legal remedy is always a way to change behavior. It works for me and red light cameras, etc. But in terms of this particular thing, we just looked at something to enhance penalties, I thought, related to fines around issues within a facility or a setting and nursing homes. So I want to understand, if we're doing this over here and now we're enhancing, you know, we're doing that in a different way here by changing the standard, you know.
I understand the question. So actually, maybe I'm best suited to respond to that, because I think the bill you're referring to was my bill, and others can do the same.
So, I had forgotten it was your bill, yeah. Mr. Chairman, but if you two want to have a dialogue, go right ahead.
It's
I hope to learn.
That memorable mark on the committee, that is my aspiration here. So the legislation to which you might be referring, and it may be that it's something different, is legislation that, among other things, would have taken a penalty, a maximum penalty level of $1,000 that was set about 25 or 30 years ago for what are called Class B violations in nursing facilities, and simply adjusted that for inflation so that it would be $2,000 now.
But that, Mr. Chairman, if I could just interject, that gets to the issue that one of the witnesses raised about. There is no control over facilities. I mean, the state can't do it. So she mentioned our budget, et cetera. Therefore, the legal profession needs to step in and provide assistance to the state, if that was the point that was made earlier. So,
right. And I just wanted to explain that was what that legislation did. That legislation would not have touched the kinds of actions that are at stake in the bill before us, but it would have brought up to date penalties for the Class B, the lower level citation,
right, I recall.
As a maximum. But please, I don't want to go beyond the scope of the question. If others before us want to respond to Ms. Atkins, I'd encourage that to happen.
If I might, Mr. Chair, excuse me, the enforcement of compliance or performance in nursing facilities is certainly not a new issue. There are really, in my mind, three different levels in operation here, at least three. The Department of Public Health is the caretaker and the group that assesses the fines that we were just discussing. That group has 1,000 people dedicated to nursing home oversight. They have not just B citations, which are the lowest level of citation. They have fines of up to $100,000 per incident or $10,000 per day. They can choose from federal fines or state fines. There is a group of 5 to 6 staff that come out to your facility, spend a week in your facility doing retrospective analysis, drawing samples, nothing you can fudge or prepare for because they pull back records. This group is funded totally by fees. They are immune to the extent that fees help in a budget delay. They have increased staff regularly as the legislature has put new requirements and mandated fines for certain behaviors. So we think that, we don't think, we know for a fact California has the most rigorous enforcement group out there. They have the most robust amount of fines and penalties they can draw to affect facility performance. Facility performance is improving. It has been for years. Is it perfect? No, it isn't. But we also have, beyond them, we have the Department of Justice, the AG's office, you have the Ombudsman Program statewide, you have disability rights, you have local law enforcement. We report, we are a fully disclosed industry, both financially and performance-wise. This stuff is all on websites. The good chairman has worked with us in the past on making that information more available to the consumers and to attorneys, which is used regularly in these types of cases. Yeah, I think that what we're really concerned about, and then beyond that, I'm sorry, you have regular professional negligence routes and the system that's available to you for that. But what I think I'd like to respond to, and I don't get to do this very often, so I'd like to defer to counsel, to respond to the issue of recklessness and why, in our mind, that is not a sufficient, it's not a second standard or second burden of proof, and it doesn't sufficiently cull out the cases as we've heard it does.
Well, but let me, that's a good thing to do, but it's not responsive to Ms. Atkins' question, as your initial comments were. So we'll have that opportunity. I want to be sure that if anybody else wants to respond to Ms. Atkins' question regarding what enhanced penalties are as opposed to an enhanced standard of proof, which is what you're beginning to address. And I just want to share one thought. If anyone else has anything to say, they should feel free, then I want to respond myself.
Very, very briefly. The one point I do want to make after that change is the bill doesn't deal with that issue. I think it is important to keep coming back to the narrow scope of the bill. It's a short bill. The reason it's a short bill is it does one thing. All of those penalties that you heard about, all of those resources that you heard about, all of those things that are supposed to protect the elders only work if you can make a case. And if people know you can't make a case, then they don't work. if you can make a case, then it serves as a deterrent. That's the issue, and that's why the standard of proof is so important in this instance.
Thank you. And I might just also add, Ms. Atkins, to your important question in response. I do think that notwithstanding Mr. Helmsen's statement that if you had a conversation with officials from the Department of Public Health, that they would say that they are do not have the resources to effectively oversee nursing homes in California, and in fact would say that the multiple studies that have asserted that that's the case are right.
Which is why the county welfare directors were here today testifying in support of the bill.
But Ms. Atkins has other questions. I want you to please feel free.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And then actually, I think Mr. Helmsman was going to my last question, which related to the reckless neglect. And then I'm done.
Okay, very good. Mr. Helmsman, you anticipated very much where Ms. Atkins was going. Sir.
If I could address that. The recklessness standard that you're talking about is the standard that is applicable when you get enhanced remedies. Is that the recklessness you're addressing, where it says you have to prove recklessness, fraud, abuse?
Or malice.
Or malice.
Right.
The reason that that recklessness requires the clear and convincing standard is very simple. In actuality, the way these cases are filed is they are always filed under neglect. Your typical malpractice case, your healthcare provider is held to the standard in a negligence case if they violate a professional standard of practice or even a non-professional standard of practice, they're held responsible under the ordinary burden of proof, preponderance of the evidence. Now, in this enhanced remedy where they put in the term recklessness, and you have to have clear and convincing evidence of that, that is typically reviewed by a judge before the case goes to trial. It's only reviewed by a judge because you have that higher standard of clear and convincing evidence. A judge looks at the evidence and determines whether or not that cause of action is going to go forward. That is there convincing evidence of recklessness, not negligence? If you take out this higher level of standard and reduce it down to the ordinary negligence standard, I have to beg to differ with the proponents of this bill. It wipes out MICRA. It wipes out MICRA because now you have the same standard of proof. So any negligent act is going to be portrayed, and I mean any negligent act because it already is in the pleadings, any negligent act of a healthcare provider is depicted as being reckless. And if the standard is only a preponderance of the evidence, you are never going to prevail. In fact, you're not even going to file a summary judgment motion because it's going to go to trial. It's not going to go to trial. It's going to go into a settlement conference. The plaintiff's attorney is going to depict for the judge, there's $100,000 in real damages, but I've incurred $350,000 in attorney's fees, so give me $500,000. That's the practical effect of reducing that recklessness standard to ordinary burden of proof.
If I might, I think we are confusing two different concepts, and I think that answer reflects that confusion. There's something called a standard of proof, and there's something else called an element of the, in this case, the tort. The statement you just heard confused those two points. The standard of proof at stake here is either clear and convincing, which is the status quo, or preponderance of evidence. The elements of the tort remain the same before this bill is enacted, and if it were to pass and be signed, after it's enacted. So it may not matter for purpose of this discussion that those two concepts were confused, but I do want for the committee's sake to understand the bill only addresses the standard of proof, not the elements of the tort. Ms. Atkins.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Senator. I appreciate the discussion. It is really helpful, I have to say. I think this is a hugely important issue. You've raised one more that I'm going to keep looking at between now and I understand this comes to appropriations and then to the floor, which actually is the MICRA issue. But there's a lot of people waiting, and a lot of bills, and I will have another opportunity on this. I think I am convinced of the necessity of this to some degree, but I am concerned about MICRA, and just for the senator's sake, want to put that on the record so that I can keep talking with folks about that piece of it, and I look forward to hearing the other questions of my colleagues.
Thank you for those important questions. Next, I think Ms. Huber, then Mr. Dickinson.
I feel a little like we're beating this same issues over and over again, so I'm going to try not to do that because I actually I'm almost there with you. I've been on the fence on this bill. I agree with lowering the standard, but I don't agree with the analysis that says that's all this bill does and that's all we should look at. We created the elements of the cause of action in 1991 when we created the tort. And we said, if we put it at clear and convincing, then we're going to also give attorney's fees and we're going to give punitive damages for this cause of action. When you're looking at lowering the standard, it is appropriate to look at the elements of the claim and say, when we lower the standard to make it easier to bring these actions, do we want to continue to have punitive damages? I think we do, but people could disagree. Do we want to continue to give attorney's fees even if you cannot prove to the level of punitive damages? Do we want to create different levels of enhanced remedies, which is one of the things that we keep talking about? I think that's a legitimate public policy question for the committee to consider as we look at lowering the standard. So I don't think the bill is just about clear and convincing evidence or making it a preponderance of the evidence. I do think what we're talking about with the MICRA caps, really getting an end run around MICRA caps, and looking at, if we make it easier for the claim, should we still have attorney's fees even if the case is not egregious enough to award punitive damages? And this is where I put on kind of my academic hat, because emotionally I'm there with the seniors. I am completely there that they want an attorney to take the case. They want to be able to, if there is egregious actions that would rise to the level of punitive damages, they should actually, that action should exist, and I'm there on with a lower standard. But when it's not that bad, when it doesn't rise to the level of punitive damages, why is an elder abuse case so different from all other claims that we do on preponderance of evidence that in wrongful death cases, we don't automatically award attorney's fees? You can beat up a child, and we don't automatically award attorney's fees. But in an elder abuse case, we're going to lower the standard to the same standard as those cases, but say that there is an enhanced penalty of attorney's fees, even if you don't get punitive damages. Why should we make that public policy decision today?
Let me first agree with the initial observation, and if I was not artful in my choice of language at the outset, let me apologize. I think it is entirely accurate to say that, quote, all the bill does is change the burden of proof. I take your point through the chair, and I think it's a point well made and one that I would agree with, that we always have to ask, that's all you're doing, but in what context? Which is, I think, really the basis for this extended conversation. So in that context, I want to pluck out a observation made by counsel who was opposed to the bill and an observation that Assembly Member Huber just made, which is both of them commented on the fact that preponderance is the ordinary burden of proof. Those are the exact words that counsel used. Preponderance is the ordinary burden of proof. That's the norm. So what we're asking is, should these particularly vulnerable cases have an even higher burden of proof than the ordinary burden of proof in litigation? Now, my policy judgment to that is no. Each member, of course, will have their own policy judgment. To Assemblymember Huber's point on attorney's fees, I would make the case that the attorney's fees are there not because of the burden of proof, but because of the need to generate interest on the part of independent legal counsel to provide some remedy for victims in the system. Because, as I said, absent the ability of those independent legal counsel to come forward and take up these cases, there's no one really there to make the case. And I would further point out, as I did earlier, that the attorney's fees are not mandatory. They're discretionary. So the judge gets to make the decision as to whether or not the fees are awarded and at what level. And we have a number of statutes in state law where prevailing plaintiff's fees are provided for if the court deems that they're appropriate, because we think that the policy objective is one we want to provide some reinforcement for with fees for people who step forward to take these difficult cases.
Can I just get one clarification?
Of course.
Because that's the second time you've said it's May, but I'm looking at the bill and maybe it's in a different section somewhere that's not contained in the bill, and the only section I find is 15-657-1, the court shall award to plaintiff reasonable attorney's fees and costs.
Keyword being reasonable.
Okay, so that's not you can decide to give them attorney's fees or not.
Let me ask our practitioner
fees.
To weigh in that's on this, if she will, please.
A shall and a may are kind of different, right?
Normally what happens is if you're lucky enough to be one of the few people who have actually gone to verdict at that level and proven all this, then, which actually has not ever been me. I have never been able to prove it, and this is all I do. I'm saying that in front of a lot of people. It's embarrassing, but it's true. So if you are, and my colleagues that have, basically you go back and they do usually, you give your hours and they say, it's just like other cases, with attorney general cases, where they say, this is too much, this is too little. And generally speaking, you know, that is not awarded the whole amount.
Okay. This has been a lengthy conversation. I want to be sure everybody has their opportunity to be heard, and then we should bring it to a conclusion. Mr. Dickinson. No hints there at all, really.
Hint taken. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I was going to ask a question, but in light of the time we've spent.
I really don't intend to cut you off. Ask what you need.
No, I want to make a quick observation, because Senator Simidian started to get to this point, and it strikes me, although I don't know what all the elements were of the negotiations when this statute was originally developed and enacted, when I looked at this, it struck me as curious that when we're talking about the standard of proof in a case involving a consumer warranty, that it is by a preponderance of the evidence. And in fact, we go beyond that to say that if there are certain prima facie facts, there's a rebuttable presumption that there's a violation of the statute. There is an attorney's fees provision under the Song-Beverly Consumer Warranty Act, and I have gotten to those fee determinations, by the way, so Ms. Huber wants to hear about the joys of that. I'll be happy to share it at another time. But it seemed to me somewhat odd that someone whose car is defective faces a standard of proof of preponderance, and if they prevail, are entitled to attorney's fees to recover, where a elderly person who is subject to abuse or neglect with fraud, oppression, or recklessness is subject to a clear and convincing standard. From my standpoint, it seems odd, because I would not elevate the damages caused to a person by virtue of their car not working, as important as that can be in our car-dependent society in California. I would not elevate that above the harm and damage that occurs to an elderly person who may, in fact, lose their life as a result. And so I think Senator Simidian earlier had it right when he said we ought to be focused on the seniors in the conditions that apply here, as opposed to the rest of the conversation that we've had, but recognize that preponderance of the evidence is hardly an out-of-place consideration in this context.
Thank you, Mr. Dickinson. Others with questions? Okay, let me make several quick observations and turn to Mr. Simidian for a brief close. In reflecting on what's been said here so far, there were some comparisons made between this context and the criminal law context. The reason that the standard of proof is so high in criminal cases has nothing to do with the offense. It has to do with the fact that someone's liberty is at stake, which is not an issue here. there is, this bill would retain a higher standard than is typical in other cases, including in negligence cases. It was said there's less evidence here, therefore there should be a higher standard. I think that the fact that there is much less available evidence here militates in precisely the opposite direction, because otherwise it's so difficult to prove, which is the point of those the proponents. And last thing I'll say, in talking with the opponents at length yesterday, one question I asked goes to the heart of Mr. Simonian's very eloquent statement about where we ought to be centered in this conversation, and that's on the patient. If I could boil down the opponent's argument to its essence, it's if this bill passes, there will be less available high-quality patient care, because money will be reallocated to litigation, because doctors will be less interested in practicing, because providers in general will be less interested in providing care. And I do think that if that is the crux of the argument, there needs to be some evidence rather than that rather hyperbolic statement in support of the claim. And I see none. I see a statement, but I don't see underlying facts to support that statement. And therefore, I'm taking all these factors into account, inclined to support Mr. Simonian's bill, and will. Mr. Simonian, you're close.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I will try and be brief in my recap. As a former county supervisor, someone who's dealt with adult protective services, someone who's dealt with the county welfare directors here, I don't think the current system works, and I think the facts make that case. I think that the system ought to be more accountable, not less accountable. I think that, as the chair has said, when the circumstances typically make it harder to make the case by virtue of the lack of witnesses and the vulnerability of the victim, that the standard should be preponderance, not clear and convincing. I think, as a number of you have referenced, that it is absolutely upside down to have a higher burden of proof for these kinds of cases than is the norm, when the burden of proof is simply preponderance in so many cases in such a wide body of the law. I, like the chair, am not convinced that the sky is going to fall if we simply make the system more effective and more accountable. I heard many of the same arguments, by the way, half a dozen years ago when we did the change in burden of proof on financial abuse. And I understand the distinction between financial abuse and physical abuse, but I heard many of the same arguments, and the sky hasn't fallen, and the evidence really isn't there. The question again, members, is do we want a system in place that serves as a deterrent, and do we want to be able to provide some measure of justice where it hasn't? And on that basis, I would respectfully ask for an aye vote and thank the chair and the committee for its patience and its engagement on this issue today. You've been very generous with your time.
Thank you, Mr. Smidian. Call the roll, please. Oh, we need a motion on the bill. Is there a motion?
I'll move the matter.
Has it been seconded? There's a motion and a second. Call the roll, please.
Fear?
Aye.
Fear, aye. Wagner? Wagner, no. Atkins? Atkins, aye. Dickinson?
Aye.
Dickinson, aye. Gaines? Gaines, no. Huber?
Aye.
Huber, aye. Huffman? Jones? No. Jones, no. Monning?
Aye.
Monning, aye. Wachowski?
Aye.
Wachowski, aye.
That bill has sufficient votes and is out.
Thank you all.
Thank you, Mr. Smidian. So the next author, the only one with the patience to withstand the past hour discussion, is Ms. Woke. Senator Woke is here on item number 15. SB 841. Senator Woke, welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Chair and members. First of all, thank you to Ellen Corbett, who ceded her place so that I could go in and ahead of her. I want to begin by thanking the committee for working closely with the staff on the proposed amendments. I do accept the amendments. I understand there's support on both sides, so I'll be very quick. With the passage of Prop 26, franchise and other fees imposed on solid waste enterprises may be limited to the actual costs of the local agencies in granting and supervising the agreements with waste haulers. 841 limits indemnity obligations required by local governments and prohibits indemnification for claims that arise out of, pertain to, or relate to the liability of the local agency. We work very closely with the League of California Cities to address their concerns, and we believe that 841 strikes a fair balance and assigns liability appropriately. I do have witnesses here to speak to the bill. I don't believe we have any opposition.
Okay, thank you. Senator Woke, your first witness in support.
I ask for your aye vote.
Thank you, Mr. Chair and members. Kelly Astor on behalf of the sponsor, the California Refuse Recycling Council.
I just want to emphasize a couple of points, if I may. No court has yet ruled that Prop 218 applies to refuse rates. The obligation, where it exists, however, is one imposed on by the Constitution on local government, and only a city or county can comply. This bill does not require implementation of Prop 218 to refuse rates. It does not provide that 218 applies. It does, however, say that waste haulers cannot be made to assume indemnity liability for the portion of the rate that they retain and the city collects. Haulers do not set franchise fees, and every franchise fee reserves, or franchise agreement rather, reserves to the city or county the right to adjust those fees. Accordingly, this bill sets an appropriate balance. Cities or counties may still seek Prop 218 indemnity from waste haulers, but only to the extent of the fees paid over to the company for services rendered. Cities and counties retain liability for their portion of the fees. We respectfully urge an aye vote.
Thank you. Others in support?
Mr. Chair, Mark Aprea on behalf of Republic Services. We associate ourselves with the comments made by Kelly Astor and would ask for your aye vote.
Thank you. Others in support?
Gene Urban on behalf of Waste Management. We, too, support the bill. Thank you.
Thank you. Others here in support of Senator Wilk's measure? Anyone here in opposition to the bill? Seeing none, Ms. Gaines. Do you have a question?
Senator Wilk.
Yes.
I represent El Dorado County.
Indeed.
And El Dorado County supervisors wrote in a letter in opposition. They said, and I was wondering if you could address their concern, the indemnity provisions within solid waste franchise agreements are the public's safeguard against malfeasance by a less than honest service provider. Can you address that, please?
Yes, with all due respect, we have tried to address these issues. We think that we have made an effort to do so. I would like to continue working with them to see if we can come to some kind of agreement so that they're more comfortable with the bill. They are the only opposition we would like. Are they still?
Assemblymember Gaines, if I could try to address some of the points that were made. I mean, while we respect the El Dorado County Board of Supervisors, we think that their opposition is misplaced. I mean, this bill simply says that a local agency may not impose an indemnity obligation except under certain circumstances relating to Props 218 and 26. So, as an example, let's say that a local agency required a franchise fee of 30%. There is no justification, let's say, for the sake of discussion, that 30% is in fact commensurate with the cost of administrating and enforcing that contract. Therefore, under Prop 26, there is a violation unless the local agency engages in the requirements of Prop 26 for a vote. Therefore, if we have a circumstance where a local hauler is not abiding by the terms and conditions of their contract, this bill has no effect on that whatsoever. This bill merely says where a municipality may require a solid waste hauler to indemnify them and defend them against someone suing them for violating Prop 26, as an example.
Also, Assemblymember, the letter that I see is dated May 24th. There are amends. I think these amends may well meet their concerns. I don't know, but I certainly will contact them and make sure that they've seen those and see if that makes them more comfortable with the bill.
I appreciate
Thank you.
That.
Mr. Thank Dickinson.
You. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm looking at page 6 of the committee analysis, the paragraph immediately under the amendment. And I'm simply trying to understand this. The committee analysis says under the proposed amendment, the solid waste company will continue to have zero liability if the extent of its responsibility for failure to comply with Props 218 and 26 is also zero. If there is some, and it goes on to say, if in other situations it's an apportionment of liability to the extent the solid waste handler and local agency are found responsible for failure to comply. I'm trying to figure out how would the franchisee have a failure? How would the franchisee fail to comply with, now we know 218 has never been held to apply to franchise fees. The question is outstanding with respect to Prop 26. Regardless of that, how would the waste hauler, how would the franchisee have some responsibility? Isn't it the local government that either complies with Prop 26 or doesn't?
Mr. Dickinson, if I may, that is absolutely correct.
So to what extent would there ever be liability under this bill that a franchisee would have?
Well, I suppose it's a remote situation, but the issue for us was we were confronted, at least in two instances, Goleta and Fresno were the examples that came to mind, where in contra negotiations, the issue of Prop 218 and indemnification came up, and in one of those two situations, the city was disinclined to even agree to implement according to 218. So we were left with a situation where we were going to assume all city liability for the failure to implement without having any tool to comply. What this bill intends to do is to say, look, to the extent there may be liability, a hauler will retain Prop 218 liability if he or she has any, to the extent of the fees that they would retain for services. But we feel, frankly, as haulers, the true exposure here might be in a situation where franchise fees are imposed at an excessive level. And if that's the case, then let us limit indemnity obligations at that line so that the city will retain all liability, if you will, for its failure to observe 218 if its fees are found to be excessive. It is a proportional adjustment in one sense, but I would concede to you that in the absence of indemnities at all, I'm not sure how a waste hauler could ever be held liable for failure to implement 218, since the obligation the state constitution imposes is on municipalities.
Thank you, Mr. Dickinson.
Okay.
Any questions or comments for Senator Wilk? Seeing none, Ms. Wilk, wish to close?
I ask for your aye vote.
Call the roll, please.
Fear?
Aye.
Dear, aye. Wagner? Atkins?
Aye.
Atkins, aye. Dickinson?
Aye.
Dickinson, aye. Gaines?
Aye.
Gaines, aye. Huber?
Aye.
Huber, aye. Huffman? Jones? Jones, aye. Monning?
Aye.
Monning, aye. Wieckowski?
Aye.
Wieckowski, aye.
Congratulations, Senator. That bill's out.
Thank you, Mr. Chair and members.
Very good. So, we are awaiting Senate authors. It is now 10:20. We, in the next hour and 35 minutes or so, intend to complete our agenda. That would mean Senators Liu, Yee, Kehoe, Weiland, Correa, Corbett should find their way here. The next author in sign-in order would be Senator Corbett, followed by Senators Weiland and Liu. I recognize that the first matter required substantial deliberation, and therefore our senators left. If in the next 5 minutes senators do not arrive, we will adjourn. Again, the sign-in order would be Senators Corbett, Weiland, Liu, Kehoe, and Correa, in that order. Senator Yee, well-timed. Welcome. Senator Yee is here on two items, item number 2, SB 105, and item number 13, SB 602. Senator, welcome. Good morning.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair and members.
Okay, Senator, before you begin, I've just apprised I need to present a bill in another committee. So, Mr. Wagner, if I could ask you please to take the gavel, and I will return imminently. Senator Yee, continue, please, item number 2, SB 105.
Not a problem. Thank you very much, and Assemblymember Wagner. First off, let me take technical amendments to address a spelling error suggested by the Senate engrossing and enrolling to add and to add the co-authors. Senators, this is about really protecting our children. There's plenty of data that indicates that more than 7,000 head injuries per year on slopes can be prevented and reduced in severity by the use of helmet, and that's what this bill will do, to require put a mandatory requirement to wear helmets for skiers and snowboarders under the age of 18. And with that, urge an aye vote.
Amanda Levy with the California Psychological Association, proud to be a sponsor of this bill. We have a division of neuropsychology who came to us to initiate this bill, and we found, and the studies are clear across the board, that using the use of a helmet reduces ski accidents that result in death at least 50% of the time. We found that patients who work with our neuropsychologists, individuals who are wearing helmets at the time, return to their pre-accident levels sooner compared to the non-helmeted counterparts. Their costs are dramatically lower than those individuals without helmets, and we urge an aye vote.
Mr. Chairman, members, Mike Dillon representing the California Ski Industry Association. This bill has been before many of you before. We have a national campaign called Lids on Kids, and we do find, as been pointed out, that helmets do make a big difference, and we would encourage your support. Thank you.
Brian Spencer with the California Medical Association in support.
Randall Hager for the California Psychiatric Association in support.
Deanna Furman on behalf of the California Nurses Association also in support.
Thank you. Any other witnesses in support? Moved and seconded. All right. Are there any witnesses in opposition to the bill? Opposition? All right. Seeing no one come forward, questions of my colleagues or comments? All right. The bill has been moved and seconded. Seeing no further comments, you may close, I suppose, Senator.
Thank you very much, and let me thank the industry for working with us and appreciate a aye vote, and thank you very much.
Thank you. Bill's been moved and seconded. Madam Secretary, call the roll.
Fear, Wagner.
Aye.
Wagner, aye. Adkins.
Aye.
Adkins, aye. Dickinson.
Aye.
Dickinson, aye. Gaines.
No.
Gaines, no. Huber.
Aye.
Huber, aye. Huffman. Jones.
No.
Jones, no. Monning.
Aye.
Monning, aye. Wachowski.
Bill is on call, and Senator Yee, you have another bill up, which is item 13, SB 602. You may open, sir.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. This is a rather complicated issue, but rather straightforward. This is really about protecting individuals' privacy as we begin to further understand that these are different times. The way in which we access information, get information, is not like the old days where you just go to the library and check out a book. There are all kinds of a variety of different ways from the online to bricks and mortars, and so this is a bill that will just simply further the extension of protecting the privacy of individuals who read materials and so on, and with that, urge an aye vote.
Thank you, Senator. Witnesses in support.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman and members. My name is Cindy Cohen, and I'm the legal director of the Electronic Frontier Foundation, one of the co-sponsors of this bill. The market for digital books has exploded in the past few years and now represents a nearly $70 million market. Sales in the past year are up 115% and expected to grow. Yet California's laws have not kept pace. The books we choose to read reveal private, intimate things ranging from our political and religious beliefs to our health concerns. And while public library records are protected in this state, the records of private booksellers and libraries are not. And this difference is being used. A U.S. attorney recently demanded that Amazon turn over the book purchase records of over 24,000 of its customers. SB 602 has two main components. The first is a heightened standard for accessing personal information assorted with books, tracking both the First Amendment to the federal Constitution and the fundamental right to privacy and the free speech protections of the California Constitution. And second, it requires transparency to keep policymakers and the public informed about requests for reading materials from the book providers. But this bill is very narrow, and it has multiple exceptions. It allows disclosure upon user consent. It allows disclosure when there is an imminent danger of death or serious physical injury. It allows disclosure if the provider believes in good faith that the personal evidence is evidence, the personal information is evidence of a crime against it or against one of its customers. And more importantly, it does not limit the ability of the government or the private parties to get book record information from other sources. And it also doesn't limit voluntary commercial disclosures in business partners or marketers. We've aligned SB 602 with the Federal Privacy Protection Act to address the DA's concerns. My friend Nikki Osher of the ACLU will talk about that more. We've worked very closely with the tech industry on this bill. Google is in support, and we believe we are close to getting the endorsement of the tech trade groups, too. The Reader Privacy Act would establish clear rules for businesses and standards for government and third-party access to reader records. Most importantly, this bill will mean that Californians can be able to feel comfortable using new digital book services or their bookstore on the corner without worrying that their information will be unprotected. I urge you to support the bill.
Additional witnesses in support.
John Ross, KP Public Affairs, on behalf of Google. We're in support of this bill. Our interest is ensuring that customers continue to have confidence in the use of these new delivery systems, electronic delivery, and we think that this bill sets appropriate restraints on the compelled disclosure of information that might dissuade people from using these services. We've worked hard with the ACLU and EFF on this bill, and we encourage and I vote.
Thank you. Additional witnesses in support.
Yes, I'm Nicole Ozer. I'm the Technology and Civil Liberties Policy Director for the ACLU in support of SB 602. I just wanted to quickly review the amendments taken in response to the concerns raised by the District Attorneys Association. Most significant are the amendments to clarify this bill's interplay with federal law and to ensure that there is no conflict with the Federal Privacy Protection Act. The Privacy Protection Act was actually passed by Congress after the Stanford Daily newspaper was searched and information was sought about photographs from a demonstration. So Congress passed this law to safeguard the First Amendment and to prohibit the police from physically searching publishers and seizing material, except for very limited circumstances. So the Reader Privacy Act is also a privacy bill, and we've taken multiple steps to make sure that this bill is consistent with the federal statute. We've done three things. One thing is make sure that there is no actual or perceived conflict between the physical searches and seizures that are prohibited by the Privacy Protection Act and the court order that's required in this bill. So no actual or perceived conflict in that language. Two, I'm making sure that this lack of conflict is clearly stated in the bill, which we do in these amendments. And the third is just mirroring the exception in the Privacy Protection Act that allows a search when there is probable cause to believe that the provider itself has committed or is committing a crime related to child pornography or sale of children. So we've made sure that that all the bills are consistent, that the Reader Privacy Act is consistent with the PPA.
Valerie Small Navarro with the ACLU, available for questions.
Thank you. Additional witnesses in support.
Christina DeCaro, representing the California Library Association, in support.
Robert Callahan here with the Technology Association of America. While we have no position on the bill, I wanted to state that we have been working cooperatively with the author's office and the sponsors, continue to work on some final amendments regarding the disclosure portion near the end of the bill, but appreciate their willingness to work with us. Thanks.
Ignacio Hernandez on behalf of the Consumer Federation of California in support of the bill.
Good morning, Eve Bukowski with TechNet. Very delighted with and thankful to the author and the sponsors for working with us to try to address many of our concerns. We believe that most of them have been addressed through the amendments that we've discussed, and provided those amendments are placed into the bill, we plan to take a support position on this bill.
Thank you. Additional witnesses in support? All right, let's move to witnesses in opposition.
Good morning, Mr. Chair and members. If it's Tuesday, it must be a yee bill that unfortunately we have to oppose.
Still friends.
With all due respect to my friend, Senator, you were unfortunately remain opposed in spite of the amendments to the bill. We thank the sponsors and the author for attempting to address some of our concerns. The interplay with the Federal Privacy Protection Act, I think the amendments go nearly all the way to fixing the problem, and the sponsors have also agreed to fix an issue regarding the admissibility of evidence seized in violation of the act and making sure that in a criminal matter that it's not inadmissible. But the simple fact remains that And given the proponent's testimony that the bill is consistent or does not violate federal law, it begs the question on why we need it. And what the bill ends up doing with these amendments is that it still requires a court order to be obtained to get these records, and the court order under this bill has stiffer requirements than a court order under current law would require. And so for that reason, we remain opposed to the bill.
Thank you. And Corey, state your name and association for the record.
Corey Salzillo with the California District Attorneys Association.
Thank you, sir. Further witnesses in opposition?
Margaret Gladstein, on behalf of the California Retailers Association. We're in the tweener category. We have been working with the author and sponsors. We are interested in clarifying that the reporting requirements in the bill do not apply to incidental sellers of books like drugstores, home improvement stores, and grocery stores who do sell some books, but it's certainly not their primary line of business. So we are working with the author and sponsor and hope to be able to resolve this issue.
Mr. Chairman and members, John Valencia, representing the California Association of College Stores. I appropriately follow my colleague, Ms. Gladstein. I want to thank the author and the proponents of the measure for working with us on a unique niche in retail that we fill, and that is the response that we have to engage in dealing with thousands of students that have textbook subsidies issued, not surprisingly, by various government programs. So with language taken in the bill today, at least on the audit and follow-up phase of filling textbook orders, we'll be relieved from what we don't believe is the essential target of the bill, which is, or focus of the bill, which is other government investigations or intrusions on the measure. So we wanted to express our appreciation for the author and the proponents of the measure working with us on that. Thank you.
Right. Questions or comments? Any further opposition, excuse me. All right. Questions or comments from my colleagues about this obvious work in progress? All right. Seeing none, sir, you may close.
Thank you very much. Let me end by just commenting on what my good friend from the DA Association mentioned. You know, we're talking about our First Amendment, and that's probably one of the most prized right and liberty that we have. And the privacy to our First Amendment is absolutely need to be guarded, because if we don't do that, then the invasion of that privacy will just absolutely destroy our democracy. And that's what we're talking about, given the fact that there are so many different variety of ways of getting information into our hands now. When we read it and acquire that information, you know, we just really need to be very, very careful that no entity can, in fact, in an unreasonable way, come in and take that right away from us, that privacy. And with that, urgent, I vote.
Thank you very much. I'll entertain a motion.
Second.
Moved and seconded. And Madam Secretary, call the roll.
Fuhrer, Wagner.
Aye.
Wagner, aye. Atkins.
Aye.
Atkins, aye. Dickinson.
Aye.
Dickinson, aye. Gaines. Gaines, no. Huber.
Aye.
Huber, aye. Huffman.
Aye.
Huffman, aye. Jones. Jones, no. Monning?
Aye.
Monning, aye. Wachowski?
Aye.
Wachowski, aye.
That bill is out. Thank you, Senator. We have Senator Corbett here with a couple of bills for us. Good morning, Senator. We have SB 182 first on the list, and we'll start there if you don't mind.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair, and appreciate you all dealing with our various, you know, schedules running back and forth between committees. I think you've seen me going in and out of the committee all morning, and I'm back, so thank you. 182, Senate Bill 182
is a bill that addresses the issue of the collection of demographic data for judicial applications. Senate Bill 182 will add sexual orientation and gender identity and expression to demographic information already collected by our governor, state bar, and the administrative office of the courts. This bill also ensures that during the transition between an outgoing governor and an incoming governor, the data for judicial applications and appointees will be passed on to the next administration. Currently, the governor, the state bar, and the administrative office of the courts collect demographic data for judicial applicants, for appointees, nominees, candidates, justices, and judges. This demographic information includes race, gender, and ethnicity, and this data is self-reported by applicants. The bill is supported by the California Judges Association, Equality California, the National Organization of Women, and several other civil rights organizations. And I have with me here today a speaker from Equality California to speak in support.
All right. Witnesses in support.
Matt Bunch, on behalf of Equality California, we are proud to be the sponsor of this legislation. We know that the California judiciary suffers from a substantial lack of diversity. We also know that information about lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender applicants is not collected. The information that we do collect is how we are able to create a diverse judiciary. Without this data, we are unable to measure the representation of LGBT people on the bench. This important bill would collect demographic information about LGBT applicants and appointees so we can further measure the diversity of our judiciary. Like the collection of ethnic, race, and gender data, this information will not be used to fill quotas and would be provided voluntarily. We would respectfully ask for your aye vote.
Additional witnesses in support. Bill's been moved and seconded. Additional witnesses in support.
Elena Perez with the California National Organization for Women in support.
All right. Are there witnesses in opposition? Seeing none, questions, comments? All right, seeing none, Senator, you may close.
Thank you very much. I just ask for your aye vote on this important bill. Thank you.
Move to second and call the roll.
Fear, Wagner?
No.
Wagner, no. Atkins? Dickinson?
Aye.
Dickinson, aye. Gaines?
No.
Gaines, no. Huber?
Aye.
Huber, aye. Huffman?
Aye.
Huffman, aye. Jones?
No.
Jones, no. Monning?
Aye.
Monning, aye. Wachowski?
Aye.
Wachowski, aye.
Needs one more vote and will remain on call. Thank you, Senator. Maybe your one more vote just walked in? No? All right. Senator, you also have... your one more vote just walked in, all right?
Atkins, aye.
I believe that bill is out.
Thank you very much.
All right. At this point, we'll move to SB 209.
Yes. Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. This bill deals with electrical vehicle charging stations. Senate Bill 209 facilitates the development of electric vehicle charging infrastructure by allowing electric vehicle owners to install an electric vehicle charger station in a common interest development. The market for electrical vehicles will continue to expand, as we know, and the number of homeowners who will need chargers will, of course, continue to grow as well. Most EVs should be charged overnight to maximize travel time on the vehicle's batteries. This response to electrical vehicle chargers by some common interest development parallels the response to those seeking to install solar panels on their homes. Solar panels, of course, provide affordable clean energy to homeowners, and however, some common interest developments block such installation of solar panels earlier in that history. That, of course, has been dealt with legislation, notably a bill by Assemblymember Smythe in 2008 that was signed by the governor to allow us to move forward with that important technology. So this bill is similar to that in this way. This is a new technology which we should foster and allow to grow, and this legislation will help that. A diverse group of electric vehicle advocates, car makers, businesses, air districts, and environmental groups support this legislation. The supporters include Plug In America, California Electric Transportation Coalition, the Alliance of Automobile Manufacturers, the Bay Area Quality Management District, and the South Coast Air Quality Management District. I'm also would like to, of course, take a moment of personal privilege and say I'm very, very proud to have a
a new and a very important manufacturer that has moved into Fremont in my district, Tesla, who will be producing thousands of electric vehicles, and they're here to testify in support as well. So another reason why this bill is good for the California economy. With me today, I have several people to speak in support.
Thank you very much, Senator Corbett. We have shifted now. The guy who was presenting a bill in another committee, but it's a pleasure to be here for Ellen Corbett Day in the Judiciary Committee. First witness in support of your bill.
Sylvia Solis Shaw on behalf of the California Electric Transportation Coalition. It is estimated that at least 70% of electric vehicle charging will occur at the home. Therefore, we believe that simplifying the installation process for these residential charging stations will lead to a positive experience for consumers and help spur the market forward. So we ask for your aye vote.
Thank you. Others in support?
Mr. Chair, Justin Malan, on behalf of the Union of Concerned Scientists, this is a priority for us. If we want to get electric vehicles on the road, we need the infrastructure. This is not a mandate on anybody. This is not a mandate on these CIDs to put it in. It simply states that we don't want unnecessary restrictions blocking the establishment of these infrastructures in these common interest properties. 25% of Californians live in multi-unit dwellings, and I would assume that a large percentage of those would really be eligible for this type of transportation because it's by nature a higher density population. It's good for the California economy, it's good for our health, and it's good for the environment. It's a good bill. We urge your vote.
Thank you. Others in support?
Mr. Chair, members, Bo Biller on behalf of Tesla Motors, and we have the 5.5 million square feet of manufacturing facility in the Senator's district, and appreciate your support.
Thank you. Others in support?
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members. Carrie Mazzoni for the Executive Council of Homeowners, an organization of homeowners associations primarily in Northern California. We have a support if amended, and we've been working closely with the author's office to address some of the issues. Unlike previous bills that have been before the legislature, similar to this, this is actually much more complex because it deals with electrical load, it deals with the possible encroachment on common areas, trenching across common areas. So getting the amendments and getting the bill in a position that we can support it, has taken some time. We are optimistic that we will work out our differences.
Thank you. Others in support?
Gene Urban, on behalf of the Alliance of Automobile Manufacturers, we support the measure.
Thank you.
Refueling infrastructure is a daunting challenge. This is helpful. Thank you.
Thank you. Others in support? Anybody here in opposition to Senator Corbett's measure? Seeing none, questions, comments, committee members? Bill's been moved and seconded. Mr. Huffman, did you have a question?
Just for the Senator, it sounds like you are working on those technical details that were outlined by Ms. Mazzoni, is it?
Yes, absolutely. In fact, we've taken several amendments already to deal with many of the issues that have been raised, and we'll continue to work with the opposition and the tweeners. We hope that the two groups that represent the homeowners or the CID organizations can work closely together and coordinate some of their amendment concerns. We've taken amendments to deal with the disclosure as to who is required to take care of the ongoing maintenance that has been taken care of. We have taken an amendment to require liability insurance to deal with the liability issues they've raised. And we have also taken amendments to deal with some of the issues with regard to encroachment on common interest areas. So we will continue to work with them, but I just wanted to let you know we've actually addressed many issues already.
Good work. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Other questions or comments? Seeing none, the bill's been moved and seconded. Call the roll, please.
Fear?
Aye.
Fear, aye. Wagner? Wagner, no. Atkins?
Aye.
Atkins, aye. Dickinson?
Aye.
Dickinson, aye. Gaines? Gaines, no. Huber?
Aye.
Huber, aye. Huffman? Huffman, aye. Jones? Jones, no. Monning?
Aye.
Monning, aye. Wachowski?
Aye.
Wachowski, aye.
The bill has sufficient votes and is out. Senator Corbett, your final bill is item 10, SB 405.
Thank you very much. 405. Mr. Chair, as you know, this is a very familiar bill. We could do it with our eyes closed.
Yes.
This allows the Judicial Council the authority to convert up to 10 subordinate judicial officer positions to judge positions. Judges converted from subordinate judicial officers will be tasked with family law and juvenile law assignments, which are the types of assignments that they have previously presided over as subordinate judicial officers. As we know, California's population
has continued to grow by more than 33%, but the number of judges has only grown by 8.5%, and we know what that does to the need to meet the demands in our courtrooms. The Judicial Council is a sponsor, and the Family Law Section of the State Bar is also in support of this bill. This is a very brief presentation because it is a simple issue, and I ask for your support.
Thank you. First witness in support.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Members, Donna Hershkowitz on behalf of the Judicial Council, sponsor of this measure. SB 405 provides much-needed flexibility to put new judgeships in place in the critical case types of family and juvenile law. This is especially important when we're in a period where we're not receiving additional judgeships to address the critical shortage of judges that we have in California. Importantly, this bill does not increase the authorization for 162 subordinate judicial officer conversions put in place in 2007. It simply expedites the ability to convert judges in these critical case types. Thank you.
Thank you. Others in support of the measure? Seeing none, questions, comments for Senator Corbett on this bill? Bill's been moved and seconded. Senator Corbett, do you wish to close?
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. I ask for your aye vote.
All right. Call the roll, please.
Fear?
Aye.
Fear, aye. Wagner? Wagner, no. Atkins? Atkins, aye. Dickinson? Gaines? Gaines, no. Huber?
Aye.
Huber, aye. Huffman? Huffman, aye. Jones? Jones, no. Monning?
Aye.
Monning, aye. Wieckowski?
Aye.
That bill has sufficient votes. Send us out. Thank you, Mr.
Thank you very much, members. Always a pleasure.
Indeed. Senator Correa is here on item number 5, SB 150. I would note for the absent senators, we still have Senators Weiland, Liu, and Kehoe to present, none of whom is here at the moment. Senator Correa is presenting one bill. Senator Correa, SB 150, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and honored members of the committee. Senate Bill 150 protects the rights of common interest development unit owners to rent their unit if such a right existed at the time they purchased it. It's a very simple bill, but very important. I ask for an aye vote.
Thank you. First witness in support.
Mr. Chair, and members, Dave Melton with California Association of Realtors. As we all know, this has been a very, very difficult market for owners of homes and purchasers of homes, and this helps protect owners who do get in financial difficulties if they cannot sell because of the market. They will be able to rent and maintain ownership rather than having it go into foreclosure or other types of very poor situations. So we very much respectfully ask for your aye vote.
Thank you. Others in support.
Thank you, Mr. Chair and members. Carrie Mazzoni for the Executive Council of Homeowners. We have a support position on the bill. We believe that grandfathering is a smart thing to do in common interest developments, and we also believe that the bill provides clarity that, in fact, common interest developments can impose renter restrictions.
Thank you. Other witnesses in support of Senator Correa's bill? Other witnesses here in opposition to the bill?
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, Ron Kingston representing the Community Associations Institute is a statewide association of homeowner associations. We've asked the senator, the author, for one amendment to allow the associations to adjust the renter restrictions upward in the case where it's merited. For example, you have a homeowner association. The maximum number of renters are occupying the properties, and something happens where one of the homeowners needs to rent. Under this bill, under the terms right now, they couldn't do that. We have asked the senator to allow this upward adjustment so the homeowner is not prevented from renting the unit and is not forced to sell the unit. That's our sole amendment. It would be very, very helpful for us to get that amendment. Thank you.
Thank you. Senator Craig, do you wish to respond to this argument that the bill requires this amendment?
Yes. Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. And again, I come back to my opening statement, which is that this is a very simple bill. You buy into an association with an understanding that you know what your rights are, and under this bill, it simply preserves those rights and responsibilities. It's a very clear bill.
Mr. Wagner, to be followed by Mr. Monning.
It is a simple bill, and it is very clear. I'm, though, struck by the testimony from Mr. Kingston. what's wrong? I can understand where we're certainly not going to take away anyone's vested rights, but if a majority of the homeowners get together and say, under circumstances, for example, a homeowner is in the military and is deployed, is working and gets transferred, they can grant more rights by a vote of the development, a majority vote of the owners, to say, notwithstanding, say, a 20% restriction, will allow 21% in these circumstances. I'm not sure what the problem is with the amendment granting more rights to the owners.
Mr. Wagner, I think that's an issue not really direct on this bill, because, again, what the bill says, if you buy into an association, if you buy into an association that gives you the ability to rent a unit at that time, all this bill says, you can't change that right later on. That's all it says. I don't think it has nothing to do with the military. It has nothing to do with anything else.
Senator, let me just interrupt this call if we can ask a question on this point, on Mr. Wagner's point. Isn't it the case that whether this bill takes effect or not, that a majority of members of an association could make the decision to vote to effectuate the goal that Mr. Kingston has identified? What in law prohibits that from happening now? What in law prohibits a majority of owners in a covenant element from affirmatively voting to provide the right that Mr. Kingston is saying is absent from this?
I don't think there is anything that prohibits that.
Yeah, just on Mr. Wagner's point.
I'd like to get that clarification from Mr. Kingston, because if that's the case, the opposition is not. I mean, let me just be clear. I don't think that is an argument to oppose this bill. And I don't intend to oppose the bill. I think it makes the bill stronger. It provides more protection for people. And I'm just curious what the objection to taking that amendment is. And maybe Mr. Kingston can tell us if there is something in the law that would prohibit that at this point.
Thank you, Mr. Wagner and Mr. Feuer. The bill doesn't provide for an expansion or an improvement for the homeowners. There's just nothing in the bill that says that. Page 2, section 2, the very first starts with line 9. It doesn't do that. So what we're suggesting is to make that adjustment, to help the homeowners make that adjustment so they can accommodate the homeowner or the homeowners that need to rent it and cannot do that. They know the bundle of goods when they bought into the unit. It's 20%, for example. They know that. But all of a sudden, something happens. We're asking for a very simple amendment, an accommodation for the homeowners. It actually, I arguably think, it helps the bill.
Through the chair?
Time out 1 second. Yeah, Mr. Correa, did you wish to say? Whose voice did I just hear? Okay, I think Mr. Correa's. Yes, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just want to say that that right exists. And by us taking that amendment, I think we'll probably be affecting the rights that exist already of some of those homeowner associations, and therefore draw opposition to this bill that isn't necessary.
Mr. Wagner, did you have your question answered?
Mr. Chair.
Let me just, first in order, I think Mr. Monning was next. Yeah.
Thank you. And again, I think my question's been answered, but I don't read this bill as prohibiting an association if they want to adjust a level upward.
That's correct.
Or address a particular circumstance of people called to military service or whatever. And as I read it, association's still free to make that decision within the association. This protects a buyer to be protected by whatever that arrangement is when they move in. Their right won't be adjusted downward. So if my understanding is correct, I'm fully supportive. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Huffman had a question. And Mr. Wyckoff, you have a question? Okay.
Just, you know, Mr. Chair, I'm reading the bill, and it seems quite clear to me that the opposition is just wrong. I mean, this is a bill that protects buyers from rules that would prohibit the rental or leasing of their property, and the opposition is concerned about rules that would broaden the ability. There's the very section that the opposition cited doesn't even talk about changing the rules for broadening the ability to
to rent or sell. And it also has a savings clause on the next page that says nothing in this is revises, alters, or otherwise affects voting process by which they amend governing documents. So I really think this whole opposition is a bit of a tempest in a teapot. It's a good bill. I applaud the author for trying to keep it narrow.
Senator Cray, would you like more help from committee members, or are you pretty satisfied with how this is going so far?
I ask for neither.
All right. All right. So no further questions or comments. Bill's been moved and seconded. Call the roll, please. Oh, it has not been moved and seconded. Excuse me. Now it's been moved and seconded.
Fear?
Aye.
Fear, aye. Wagner? Wagner, aye. Adkins? Adkins, aye. Dickinson?
Aye.
Dickinson, aye. Gaines? Gaines, aye. Huber?
Aye.
Huber, aye. Huffman? Huffman, aye. Jones?
Aye.
Jones, aye. Monning?
Aye.
Monning, aye. Wachowski?
Aye.
Wachowski, aye.
That bill is out. Congratulations.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Okay.
Thank you, honorable members of the committee.
Okay. All right. Now we have Senator Liu, who is here on item 1, SB 62. Senator, good morning.
Good morning, and thank you very much, Mr. Chair, committee members. This is a district bill to prevent property sale fraud and protect homeowners and renters in Los Angeles County. When the county records a notice of default or a notice of sale for a home, the property resident will receive a timely warning in the mail. This bill builds upon a successful fraud prevention program already in statute in L.A. County. The new bill is sponsored by the L.A. County Board of Supervisors. This legislation has had extensive support from consumer groups and law enforcement and has no opposition. The bill is identical to SB 878, which passed last year with bipartisan vote and also received no opposition. Unfortunately, Governor Schwarzenegger vetoed it. The only issue raised in last year's veto was that the bill might be redundant because legal foreclosure notices are already posted on properties. The veto overlooked a common complaint. Unscrupulous landlords take the postings down, tell the tenant nothing is wrong, and keeps collecting the rent. Residents are later evicted with little notice, and the mailing will provide additional warning. So I ask for your support on the bill.
Thank you, Senator Liu. First witness in support.
Good morning, Mr. Chair, members of the committee. My name is Rigoberto Reyes. I'm the acting director for the County of Los Angeles Department of Consumer Affairs. With me is Tim Bissell, my chief deputy director, and our department's key person for this bill. Los Angeles County has operated the homeowner notification program since 1996. And under this program, homeowners are notified when a deed, a grant deed, or a quitclaim deed is recorded. This gives the homeowner the opportunity to review a copy of the document and alerts them to forgeries and problems with the document. Since its inception, this has been an important and successful program in fighting real estate fraud. Last year alone, more than 450,000 notifications were mailed to homeowners, and our department assists more than 25,000 homeowners each year. Homeowners strongly support this program. A survey card is sent with every notification, and more than 99% of homeowners who return the survey approve of the program. SB 62 will expand this popular and successful program to include notification to homeowners and tenants when a notice of default or sale is recorded. These notifications are desperately needed because fraud against homeowners in foreclosure has risen dramatically in Los Angeles County and throughout the state. In 2007, for example, our department received only 44 complaints against fraudulent foreclosure consultants and loan modification companies. In 2010, that number increased to 542 complaints. Providing notification to homeowners who have received a notice of default or sale will reduce foreclosure fraud and give homeowners the information and assistance they need as they work to save their homes. We respectfully ask that you vote yes on SB 62.
Thank you. Others in support?
Mr. Chair, members, Dan Felizotto on behalf of Los Angeles County District Attorney's Office. As my colleague stated, with the downturn in our housing market, the increased rate of foreclosure fraud has inundated our real estate fraud division. We believe that this small effort will help reduce the instances of this type of fraud and ask for your aye vote.
Thank you. Others in support?
Good morning, Mr. Chair and members. Corey Salzillo on behalf of the California District Attorneys Association in support of the bill.
Thank you. Others in support? Any opposition to the bill? Seeing none, colleagues, questions or comments for the senator? Mr. Money.
Just more of a comment or clarification. I think the provision that also requires notification of tenants or occupants is of particular importance because often an owner of a property may be fully aware of proceedings and tenants find out
too late
in the game.
Right.
So I applaud you for bringing this forward. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Money. Other questions or comments? Ms. Atkins.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is just a district bill. I see previous legislation, AB 2618, Nastandi gave allows counties to choose to do a program like this. Is that?
Yes.
So it's just counties have to make the decision and
right.
could
LA
do
County,
so.
LA County has a program like this, and they just want to make sure that the extra posting happens through legislation.
Okay.
Your county could do the same if your supervisors chose to do so.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Atkins. Is there a motion on the bill?
I'll move the matter.
Second. Moved and seconded. Call the roll, please. Well, actually, Ms. Lou, do you wish to close?
Simply ask for your support in the bill. Thank you.
Thank you. Call the roll, please.
Fear?
Aye.
Fear, aye. Wagner? Atkins?
Aye.
Atkins, aye. Dickinson?
Aye.
Dickinson, aye. Gaines? Huber?
Aye.
Huber, aye. Huffman? Huffman, aye. Jones? Monning?
Aye.
Monning, aye. Wachowski?
Aye.
Wachowski, aye.
That bill has sufficient votes and is out. Thank you. Thank you. Now, Senator Kehoe is unable to be with us this morning and has asked if two of her particularly worthy staff members can participate in her behalf, a request which, of course, we grant. So on item number 3, SB 117, we have Linda Barr from the Senator's office presenting the measure. Ms. Barr, welcome.
Good morning, members, Mr. Chair. Thank you for allowing me the opportunity to present. I'm Linda Barr from Senator Kehoe's staff. And first, we'd like to accept the clarifying amendment listed on page 4 of the committee analysis, and we'd like to thank your staff for working with us on the language. SB 117 would prohibit state agencies from entering into a contract of $100,000 or more with businesses that fail to provide employee benefits for same-sex married couples that are equal to registered domestic partners and heterosexual married couples. It will basically protect the 18,000 same-sex couples who are legally married in California, as well as those who are legally married in other states. As we know, a significant portion of all employee compensation comes in the form of benefits, such as health benefits and bereavement leave, moving expenses, and other sorts of things. Providing these benefits to employees with heterosexual spouses and registered domestic partners, but not to legally recognized same-sex married couples, would be unfair and discriminatory. I have with me today Matt Bunch from Equality California, who can answer any questions you may have. Equality California is the sponsor. And the bill is supported by the California Nurses Association, Commission on the Status of Women, Gray Panthers, and many other groups. And we respectfully ask for your aye vote.
Thank you, Ms. Barr. Did your witness wish to testify or merely available for questions?
I'll testify very, very briefly. Matt Bunch here on behalf of Equality California, happy to be the sponsor of the bill. Providing the same benefits to an employee with a domestic partner or with same-sex or opposite-sex spouse ensures that workers receive equal pay for equal work, and that's why we're supportive of this bill.
Thank you very much. Bill's been moved and seconded. Questions, comments for Ms. Barr on behalf of Ms. Keough? Seeing none, Ms. Barr, I'm sorry to say this will be less challenging than perhaps you had anticipated. Do you wish to close?
I respectfully ask for an aye vote, members. Thank you.
All right. Call the roll, please.
Fear?
Aye.
Fear, aye. Wagner? Wagner, no. Atkins?
Aye.
Atkins, aye. Dickinson? Dickinson, aye. Gaines? Huber?
Aye.
Huber, aye. Huffman?
Aye.
Huffman, aye. Jones?
No.
Jones, no. Monning?
Aye.
Monning, aye. Wachowski?
Aye.
Wachowski, aye.
Congratulations. That bill is out.
Thank you.
Let's see if your colleague fares as well. We also have Gil Topete on behalf of Senator Kehoe, who is here on item number 9, SB 337.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Before I begin, there are technical amendments found on page 6 of the analysis that I'd like to adopt at this time.
Okay. Very well.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. SB 337 clarifies that a tenant in a single family or more multifamily housing has the right to post political signs where they live. These are political signs that are directly related to an election or legislative vote, including elections for candidates to public office, the initiative and referendum process, as well as issues that come before local boards and public commissions. Under existing law, there are protections for tenants from being retaliated against by the landlord for exercising their rights. However, it does remain unclear whether or not tenants exercising their rights to expression using political signs are equally protected. Almost 40 million people call California home, and approximately 40% of our state's population live in some form of rental housing. That's approximately 16 million people who, by virtue of their property status, are not allowed to freely express themselves at the very place they call home. SB 337 ensures that the right to political expression through posting a political sign is extended to everyone, regardless of property status, and allows local ordinances to establish the time limits on how long the signs may be posted. Absent a local ordinance, the bill allows a landlord to establish a reasonable time period for the signs to be posted, at least 90 days prior to an election and at least 15 days after the election. The bill before you today, members, removes the opposition of the California Apartment Association and the California Association of Realtors and has the support of the ACLU, California Congress of Seniors, Tenants Together, and Western Center on Law and Poverty. On behalf of Senator Kehoe, I respectfully request an aye vote.
Thank you very much. First witness in support. The bill's been moved and seconded. Please.
Mr. Chairman and members, Francisco Lobaco, on behalf of the American Civil Liberties Union, we urge you to move the bill forward. We'd prefer to see a broader bill. It's the nature of the process. It's still a good bill. It provides clear statutory guidelines that arguably don't exist. So for those reasons, we think it's worthy of your support. Thank you.
Thank you for that unbridled enthusiasm. Next witness in support of the bill.
Nicole Wordleman on behalf of the City of Berkeley, who would also prefer a broader bill, but is still in support.
Deborah Carlton with